Good morning, everyone. Okay, here are my disclosures. Liver disease and IBD is very common. We're all gastroenterologists. We've all had some training in hepatology, so we should be able to deal with this. There are studies looking at the average prevalence of LFT abnormalities in patients with liver disease, and depending on how you define this, this can be quite prevalent, and it also depends on whether the LFT abnormalities are transient or persistent. Here's an example of a study that we did at Mayo about 10 years ago, and we looked at a one-year slice of all the IBD patients that we saw, whether they were being seen for IBD or non-IBD reasons, looked at their hepatic biochemistries, and found that a third of the patients at least had transient elevations in their hepatic biochemistries. The ones that were persistent, it was a much smaller group, and ultimately 5% of these patients were diagnosed with chronic liver disease. So here's that in graphical format. You can see that 29% of the patients had abnormalities, and of those patients, ultimately, 5% of all the patients ultimately were diagnosed with PSC, but you can see miscellaneous causes as well, including autoimmune hepatitis. Don't forget that's clearly associated with ulcerative colitis, and many of these patients with autoimmune actually have that rare autoimmune PSC overlap. One of the ways you can tell that is if the transaminases are sort of more elevated than what you would normally expect in a PSC patient, and oftentimes you'll see that their LFTs will fluctuate with corticosteroids. The important reason to recognize this, you know, you're just blowing off the LFTs, is that people with abnormal LFTs actually have a significant impact on their survival. That's probably driven by the PSC patients within that, but we actually showed in that cross-sectional study that the patients that had abnormal LFTs had a worse survival over the next 4 years. So something to keep in mind. Again, even patients with mild hepatic biochemistries had a 5 times higher risk of mortality even after adjusting for age. And so this is something important to recognize. There was not an association when we tried to look at the LFT abnormalities and flares of IBD, we saw no relationship whatsoever. And so contrary to older studies, we did not see that relationship. So we're gonna talk about primary sclerosing cholangitis, small duct PSC, which is basically PSC without the visible bile duct abnormalities on ERCP or MRCP, and briefly talk about some of these other conditions. Again, PSC, chronic cholestatic liver disease. When you see that alkaline phosphatase elevated, you've got to think about this, and ultimately, roughly 5% of patients will be diagnosed with PSC amongst your ulcerative colitis patients. There's an interesting study from Scandinavia recently, a population-based study, where all the patients with IBD got basically MRCP or its equivalent, and the prevalence of PSC radiographically was actually 3 times higher than what you would have expected just based on the LFTs alone, and we see this all the time. In fact, if I see a patient that has pancolitis and rectal sparing and backwash ileitis, even if they have normal LFTs, you should think about maybe doing an MRCP on that patient, because there's a good chance that that patient has PSC and has normal LFTs. And so think about this. It's out there. Once you recognize that phenotype of PSC-IBD, you can consider that. Don't forget that there's really not any clear-cut relationship between the PSC and the underlying IBD. In fact, anecdotally, it seems like it's almost an inverse relationship, and oftentimes these patients have a very mild pancolitis, at least for a time period. Again, this is obvious to all of us. We know this recognition. I think the big change over the years is that the prevalence of doing diagnostic ERCPs has gone down, and so it's just much easier to do an MRCP. For our patients with PSC at Mayo Clinic, To survey for bile duct cancer, which is one of the major causes of mortality, we will do an annual MRCP, check their LFTs every 3 months, and also check an annual CA19-9. And so if you really want to impact their survival, you really have to monitor for cholangiocarcinoma. Another point to make while we're talking about PSC, this often comes up, is can I give biologics in PSC patients? And the answer is you can, but don't expect that the biologic is going to help the course of PSC. We recently published our experience in Alimentary Pharmacology and Therapeutics this year, looking at the impact of biologics on the LFTs and PSC patients, including our experience with vedolizumab. Some people had theorized that maybe vedolizumab would help PSC. In our retrospective experience, it didn't seem to. It had no effect on the LFTs. The only biologic that seemed to have an effect on the LFTs was adalimumab, and there was a slight statistically significant, but maybe not clinically significant, reduction in the alkaline phosphatase. Another consideration in PSC patients is liver transplant. Can you give biologics in those post-liver transplant patients? And the answer is you can. We often go with vedolizumab in those patients now, but at times, if you're forced to, we will give anti-TNFs, recognizing that they could have a higher rate of serious infection with that. And we published a small case series on that. Fatty liver is actually one of the most common causes of LFT abnormalities in patients with IBD. This exists in up to a third of our IBD patients. We're seeing more and more of it. Certainly rapid weight loss can contribute. Patients on TPN can get these abnormalities, and it's just something that we need to be concerned about. In our Crohn's patients, up to a third of them are going to have cholelithiasis. And this is because of the interruption in the enterohepatic cycling of bile salts. They get an increased tendency to form cholesterol crystals in bile. Fortunately, most of these patients are asymptomatic, so when we find cholelithiasis in our patients on cross-sectional imaging, that doesn't trigger a cholecystectomy. They have to be symptomatic from their gallstones. Portal vein thrombosis, this is very common in the post-surgical setting. Recall that we've heard that inflammation can sort of non-specifically activate your coagulation cascade, so it's a prothrombotic condition anyway, and then the patients are going through the stress of surgery, so that's always in the differential when you see a patient with abdominal pain or a bump in their LFTs in that post-operative setting. Here's an example of a patient who had an IPAA, and you can see that of the patients who had cross-sectional imaging, up to 45% had at least some portal vein thrombi. So a very important consideration to make in your post-op patients. We're going to have a quiz on this later. I want you all to memorize this. This is just an example of azathioprine and 6-mercaptopurine metabolism, and showing you that on the one side you get the methylated metabolites. The methylated metabolites are the ones that will result in potential hepatotoxicity, and it's often manifested as a bump in transaminases. The problem with the methylated metabolites is there are a lot more people walking around with high methylated metabolites than there are with abnormal LFTs. So the presence of high 6-MMP levels alone doesn't mean I stop the drug, but I just recognize that that patient might be at increased risk for LFT abnormalities down the road. The other concern, I think, we'll get to that in a second. So the methylated metabolite problem is more of a dose-dependent thing. So if you decrease the dose of azathioprine, the LFTs will get better. However, I do believe that there are patients who get more serious chronic liver disease later on that seems like it's driven more by the 6-TGN metabolites. And those are the patients who get the serious complications that often present with signs of portal hypertension, and they'll have either nodular regenerative hyperplasia or almost a veno-occlusive disease of the liver picture. The true incidence of these events remains unknown. In my own practice, it's uncommon, but I've definitely seen patients who had azathioprine-induced chronic liver injury. Fortunately, if you recognize it early enough, you stop it, they get well compensated, and they can stay stable for a long time. So it is a concern, fortunately rare. Here's an example of a study from Spain, looking at over 700 patients. You can see that 15% of the patients at some point had elevated liver enzymes, and when they defined the hepatotoxicity, 5%, and that had to be greater than 2 times the upper limit of normal. You can see that the most frequent explanation was the thiopurine. Most of these patients normalized with time, but in some cases the drug had to be discontinued altogether, so something to be concerned about. So I think in patients where the transaminases are relatively low level, you can probably continue to monitor them, but if they're persistently elevated, you probably have to dose reduce, and in some cases, again, very rare, you might have to discontinue the drug altogether. In the AGA guidelines on immunomodulators, that's was published about 10 years ago, they don't really specify. They said just check frequent LFTs. I know in my own practice, I check LFTs every 3 months, and we make adjustments along with that. Methotrexate is always a concern, liver abnormalities, and I think you're going to be more likely to see this in patients that have risk factors for liver injury, such as alcohol use, if they already have abnormal baseline LFTs, or if they have, say, for example, obesity or type 2 diabetes. These are concerns. The historical practice was at once the patient had received a cumulative dose of 1.5 or 2 grams, you would do a liver biopsy. I don't think we're really doing that anymore, but when we monitor the LFTs in these patients, when you start seeing those persistently elevated transaminases, you really need to think about it. And again, in those patients that have risk factors for fatty liver, or the patients that are drinking alcohol or obese, you really might want to think twice about using methotrexate. Just something to consider. Anti-TNF therapy is another cause of abnormal LFTs. Fortunately, this is rare and most cases self-limited. There was a great study published from the Boston, the Partners collaboration, a retrospective cohort of over 1,000 patients, and they found that roughly 6% of patients on anti-TNF therapy developed elevated transaminases. Fortunately, it was blamed on the anti-TNFs in only half, and it was mostly self-limited, but in 1% of cases or so, there was enough liver abnormality going on to warrant a liver biopsy. And most of these patients will have features of autoimmune hepatitis, so think about checking an ANA or an anti-smooth muscle antibody. But basically, in those cases, I think the prudent thing to do would be to discontinue the anti-TNF and consider corticosteroids. Vedolizumab, I think anecdotally, we'll see sometimes transient bumps in the transaminases, but again, a self-limited problem, and I don't think we're seeing as much of this autoimmune type hepatitis in the patients with vedolizumab. Treatment, again, cessation of the anti-TNF and consideration of corticosteroids. All right, so in patients, some people will actually monitor the LFTs. I have to say that in my typical practice in patients on anti-TNFs, I'm not checking the LFTs. If I'm seeing the patient back, once a year, sure, I'm getting LFTs, but I'm not doing this every 3 months. I think the one important thing to remember, especially if you practice in a high prevalence area, don't forget to check the chronic hepatitis profile. Patients that are either surface antigen positive or core antibody positive, you should really think about prophylaxis. Some of you went to the case breakout sessions yesterday. We presented several cases and patients basically at risk. If you're going to go with a biologic, you should probably think about entecavir or something along those lines. So I'm going to stop there, and we'll move on to the questions. Thank you.